Now, am I presenting my screen now? Just can anyone confirm?
No, sir.
Hello? Hello?
No, sir, not visible.
Somebody confirm me so that I can start my lecture.
This is visible, sir.
Yeah, fine. Okay, thank you. Once again, very good morning to all. I welcome you all for this course on wireless communication. Okay, what we'll try to do in today's class is we'll try to see the basic introduction part of this wireless communication. Okay, and then probably from the next class onwards, we'll try to see the actual concepts of the wireless communications. We will start with cellular communications, basically cell layout structure. Okay, and then we'll try to see the different types of handoffs that we'll be having in this particular cellular systems. And then we'll try to see the path-less models and probably the OFDM and MIMO concepts. And if time permits, even we'll try to look at some multiple access techniques also. Okay, this would be the things or the contents that we will be covering in the course of wireless communication. But for today's class, okay, just let me go through quickly, okay, what is the contents that I'm putting it in for the. In today's class, we will just try to look at the basic definition for a wireless communication, or we'll try to understand in terms of, okay, wired communication, how wireless communication is different, and why do we need to go for this wireless communications. Okay, and at the same time, we'll try to see the existing wireless communications, most probably, okay, which we are using it right now. So we'll try to classify this wireless communication depending upon the mobility aspect, or probably the depending upon the radio transmission, or especially the transmission aspect. We'll try to see the types of wireless communications, and then the major part of that we will try to cover the basic challenges that we have in wireless communications. Because once we are going to implement it, this wireless communication, okay, as the medium is common, so we will have lot many challenges. So we need to identify that particular challenges, and then we need to overcome that particular challenges. Okay, that is the major part of today's class. And then we'll try to see the basic wireless communication technique, okay, which is what we will try to cover in this semester. which is cellular communications or cellular mobile communications. Basically, the cellular communications is a part of wireless communications. Okay, so we will try to look at the different generations of the cellular systems, right from the first generation to the upcoming fifth generation. We'll try to see the specifications and the rest of the technicalities with respect to these different generations. So broadly, this is what we are going to cover in today's class. Okay, let me get into this basic the introduction part of it. Okay, so the basic prerequisites for this wireless communications is your digital communication and digital signal processing. Okay, so I hope these particular subjects you have covered in the previous semesters. So keeping in the mind, okay, we will start up with the basic communication system and what are the different blocks of this particular communication system, and then we will try to see what modifications that we are doing it for this wired communication in order to make it a wireless communication. Okay, so I hope this particular thing everyone might be knowing it. A wired communication, basically communication system, the basic blocks of your communication system would be what? You will have a transmitter and a receiver. Okay, so somebody is transmitting and the other person is receiving that particular information. Okay, and the basic definition of wired communication is this transmitter and receiver are being connected with a wire. Okay, that is what we call it as wired communication. Or in other words, we can say that transmitter and receiver, okay, basically will have a physical path. Like you have a path from transmitter to receiver. Hence, we call that as basically a wired communication. The yellow line, whatever that I'm representing it, okay, is what we call it as basically a physical path. So you have a physical path between transmitter and receiver. Hence, we call this as basically a wired communication. So quickly, let us look at what are the components of your transmitter and what are the components of a receiver. Okay, you can see that I hope you might have seen in your analog communication and digital communication, okay, basic structure of a communication system. Okay, you have at the input of that, you have a source. It may be an analog source or it may be a digital source. If you are dealing with an analog source, you are supposed to convert that into digital. In digital or in analog communications, you might have studied about converting an analog signal to a digital signal. Okay, if it is not a digital source, you have to put another basic A to B converter. The basic blocks of that are sampling, quantization. Okay, these concepts are being already covered. And then on top of that, okay, what you have it is you have source encoder. The basic job of that source encoder is whatever the source that you have, the output of that particular source, you have to represent with a minimum number of bits. That is the basic idea of your source encoder. And the next block of that is the channel encoder. And I hope, we have seen this channel encoder also. This channel encoder is basically used to identify, or basically detect and correct the errors that are presented because of the medium that we have. Okay, so these channel encoder and all, for example, you can take that, suppose if I'm trying to transmit a symbol which is having bits 010, which is basically a 3-bit symbol. Now what I can do is I can add one more bit to this, which basically that parity bit, I can say that as parity bit, that represents the number of ones in that. As I have considered 010, I have only one. Okay, so along with this, we'll try to add a parity bit, and then this 4 bits will try to transmit it to the receiver. So at the receiver side, what do we do? It is in the counterpart of this channel encoder, you have a channel decoder. So we'll try to look at first 3 bits and we'll try to observe the 4th bit. If the 4th bit, if the same information is being transmitted, that means on the receiver side, if I'm getting 010, then obviously the number of parity bits you'll be getting it 1. So in parity bit column, if you are getting 1 or 0, depending upon that, you will identify whether you have a error or not. That is a simple mechanism. Okay. And on top of that, you have different channel encoder techniques, convolution encoder, okay, block encoders and all that we have it. Okay, but I hope all these things are being covered in your digital communications. And then on top of that, you have a concept called modulator. Okay, so I hope this modulation also we have covered in analog communication as well as digital communication. So basic concept of modulation is, okay, changing the parameters of your carrier signal in accordance with your message signal. Okay, so either you are changing amplitude, frequency or phase. So respectively, you are going to get amplitude modulation, phase modulation or frequency modulation if it is analog communication. In case of digital communication, we will name it as ASK, PSK and FSK. Okay, and apart from this, this digital techniques, digital communication techniques, you have QPSK and then quadrature amplitude modulation. Okay, and different modulation techniques are also available for us. Okay, so these are the basic blocks of your transmitter. And you can see that on the receiver side, you have the counterparts of that. Okay, once the information is being passed through the channel or the medium, in this case, it is a wire, then whatever is present at the input of your receiver, okay, first demodulator, okay, we'll try to demodulate the signal and then we'll try to perform channel decoder and then we'll try to do the source decoder, like the counterparts of what you have done it in your transmitter. So that, okay, you will get back the information. So this is basic communication system. I hope, okay, everybody will be doing it. Okay, now what we'll do is, now having understood about the basic communication system, our communication system, okay, we'll try to see this. We have represented it as basically a wire. So, or I'll call this as basically this as a medium. Okay. And this particular medium we are connecting with a wire. Hence, we are calling it as a wired medium. Or in other words, even you can call it as a guided medium, because you are connecting a wire or whatever the information that you have, you are trying to guide it through this physical path. Hence, we call it as a guided medium. In case of wireless communication, which, okay, what we will try to do is, you do not have a physical path between your transmitter and receiver. Hence, okay, you will have, we will call such a kind of thing as unguided medium, because basically you do not have any physical path between, okay, transmitter and receiver. We will try to transmit in the form of electromagnetic waves, okay, and we'll try to radiate it using antennas. Okay, so quickly, what are the options that we have as far as this particular medium is concerned? We can see that the medium, this particular medium, whatever I'm talking, okay, either it may be a wired medium or it may be a wireless medium. In case of wired medium, we are trying to look at the possibilities are a twisted pair cable or a coaxial cable or a fiber optic cable. Okay, so you can see that in case of twisted pair cable, okay, you have two copper wires twisted together and with that particular wire that are being connected. Okay, and in case of coaxial cable, you will provide some shielding for that particular copper wires. Okay, so that, okay, the outside interference would be much reduced in case of coaxial cable. Okay, especially the examples for this coaxial cable is like the cable TV wires, whatever that we are going to look at it. And the other one is fiber optic cable. This fiber optic cable is basically the information is being transmitted. Okay, and the fiber optic cable provides high bandwidth, so that is the reason why, okay, we will try to most of the time, okay, we will try to make use of this fiber optic cable. But anyhow, all these three things have their own advantages and disadvantages depending upon our context, and whichever is suitable for our communication system, one has to make use of these three, okay, in one of these particular three mediums or wired mediums that we are considering. Okay, so I'm just trying to we'll try to come back to this wireless medium. Okay, now, okay, as I said, okay, we'll try to look at the definition of wireless and then we'll try to look at the options of this. Okay, so these are what the pictures corresponding to, okay, twisted pair and then a copper coaxial cable and then an optical fiber cable. Okay, so this is all still we are dealing with only a wired communication. Okay, now we'll just try to look at the wireless communication, and then we'll try to look at this concept of the union and the possibilities.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, your voice is breaking in the middle of the flow, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just a minute. Now, okay, just try to check it out now.
It is fine for now.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, sir.
Right, okay. Now, we will try to look at the concept of wireless communication. Okay. As we said previously, okay, the complete block diagram of wired communication. In case of wireless communication also, as we said, the basic blocks are transmitter and receiver, which is what we have already studied, right? Transmitter and receiver. Now the basic difference comes here is, now this particular thing, okay, like the signal transmitted, okay, whatever the signal, information signal, is being radiated from an antenna. You can see that the medium now here is free space for us. That is the basic difference between a wired communication and a wireless communication. That means you have to transmit the information, either you transmit or receive the information in the form of electromagnetic waves in free space. That is what we call it as a wireless communication. Okay. You can see here that we are trying to put up, we are making use of some antennas over here. And the medium is common. As we said, or as we have looked at in the previous slide, the medium corresponding to this particular thing, okay, we call it as an unguided medium, because you do not have a single path from transmitter and receiver. As the medium is common, you will have multiple paths. So once you have these multiple paths between your transmitter and receiver, because you may have objects in between transmitter and receiver, each and every object may reflect the signal, and subsequently that signal is being received by the receiver. Okay, so these are what the things that we have it. So there is no, okay, guided path that we have in case of your wireless communication. So this is what we said, okay, this is going to, transmitter will be radiating the information, and at the same time in the form of electromagnetic waves, and the receiver is going to receive that, okay. The same a portion of that will capture by this particular antenna, and then subsequently it will be processed, and you will be get the, you'll be getting the information that is being transmitted. Okay, and okay, so the basic definition for a wireless communication now would be transmitting or receiving information using electromagnetic waves in free space. Okay, so this is the basic difference between your your wired communication and a wireless communication. Now, okay, having said about the basic definition of this particular wireless communication, okay, as we said, the medium, whatever that we said, is basically, it is an unguided medium, and you can see that what are the possibilities that we have in this particular things. Okay, either I can transmit, okay, some radio waves, or I may transmit it using a sound waves, or I may go for optical waves. Okay, basically these sound waves and optical waves, you can see that for a particular, in particular case of optical waves, if you have, okay, obstruction in between, you will not be able to receive at the receiver side. Hence, okay, will not use this optical waves, or sound waves also would be the same case. So majority of the time we would use radio waves. Okay, we'll try to see the options. Okay, probably a little later. So this is basic difference between a wired communication and a wireless communication. And we'll try to look at now, why do we need to go for this wireless communication at all? Okay, so as everybody understands, okay, in case of wired communication, just imagine, okay, the initial days when we wanted to have a communication in the home, you used to have a landline, and then from there a cable is being connected from that landline to the nearest telephone exchange, and from there, okay, it is being connected with a wire to the main exchange. So you have a wire that is being connected from your landline to the exchange. Okay, so wherever like you wanted to have that communication, whoever want to have that, then a wire need to be laid down from the home to the exchange. Okay, that's the basic problem that you have, and at the same time, you will not be able to, like, the moment when you get a call, you have to go there and you need to talk. That's the basic things that we have as far as the initial mobiles or initial landlines are considered. Okay, but as a user, what we expect it is, like, we do not want to be connected with this particular wires, because while I'm on a call, I would like to roam here and there, and then even then I would like to have that particular communication established. So this wireless communication provides a flexibility of doing that. So hence the first one that I have considered it as freedom from wires. So I did not be connected with any wires. Okay, that is the first thing that we have. And then the other option that we have, it is mobility. As I said, mobility is the biggest factor that we have for wireless communication, because having a mobile handset or digital device in your hand, you can move here and there, okay, still you have a communication established with your receiver. So the biggest advantage that you have is mobility. And then the other option that you have, it is global coverage. Global coverage is basically, probably you would find some remote areas where a wire may not be laid down, okay, then in that particular cases, this wireless communication would be very useful. Okay, so almost covering the entire areas using this particular wireless communication is possible. And the other option would be easy installation, and then the cost savings. You can see that once we are like, you need not lay down a particular wire. Other than that, you can buy a simple handset that we can take it. Okay, and the installation and all those things are quite simple nowadays. Okay, everybody is using this particular cellular or mobile communications. Okay, that gives that particular feeling. Okay, now let's look at the types of your wireless communications. What are the different types that you have it? Okay, first we'll try to look at the this classification of this wireless communication depending upon the mobility aspect. Means what? Whether the transmitter and receiver, whether they are mobile or whether they are fixed or whether they are on a high speed train kind of thing. Okay, so this particular thing, the first one we are trying to look at is the first classification that we are making, it is fixed wireless. Fixed wireless is basically what? You have a transmitter and the receiver, both of them are fixed. Example could be, you have a laptop or a desktop, and you have a printer, and you wanted to have a wireless printer. If you're trying to consider a wireless printer, okay, you're trying to give simply the printout from your laptop or desktop, where, okay, your laptop and printer, both of them are fixed, and you are having a communication between your laptop and printer. That is one example for fixed wireless. And other example that I've shown it here, it is a satellite to your earth station. So from the satellite, okay, and then the earth station that I'm trying to consider, okay, we are trying to fix up that particular things, and then from there we are trying to make up a wireless path between your transmitter and receiver. Okay, and then the other option is possibly portable wireless is basically, I hope all of us might have used this Wi-Fi, where what you can do it is a Wi-Fi device, okay, a wire is being connected to your Wi-Fi device, and from there, from that particular Wi-Fi device, okay, within that particular area you will be getting the signals. Okay, so what you can do is, if you want to take out that particular Wi-Fi device and some you can go anywhere else, and then you can still be connected. Okay, that is the wireless aspect that we have in this particular portable. Or two mobile handsets, okay, when I'm making okay hotspot on in one mobile device, and the other mobile device nowadays can also access the okay the data of the first mobile device, okay, there also the communication or the wireless communication that is being done, okay, is what, okay, you can classify that into this, like a portable Wi-Fi. And the other, the third option is mobile, or the example of that could be the cellular. In case of mobile, what you're trying to do is the user is okay subjected to mobility. That means he has a flexibility that he can take that particular handset and he can move from here and there. Okay, the best example for this mobile wireless communication or a cellular is basically the cellular communication, where okay you will deploy a base station, and the user okay is having mobile handset in their hand, can roam okay here and there while having on a particular call. Okay, that means he is subjected to mobility. This is a basic classification depending upon the mobility aspect. Okay, somebody else can also classify this, okay, depending upon the kind of transmission that we are making it. As I said, okay, probably the radio waves, optical waves and sound waves, those are what the options that you have. Or in that particular radio waves, okay, if I'm trying to consider the radio transmission, okay, classification depending upon the radio transmission, where the basic advantage of this particular radio transmission is the signal can penetrate through the walls of the building. Okay, the best example of that is basically your cellular tower, and from there you are able to get back the information even though you have the buildings okay in between. Okay, of course, okay, each and every wall or each and every floor of that particular building is going to attenuate that particular signal, but still okay the signal will be able to okay we'll have that all that mathematical calculations, and then accordingly we'll try to see to it that within that particular cell we'll have a sufficient okay amount of signal strength to the particular user. Okay, we'll try to okay explore this particular concepts probably a little later. Okay, as of now let's look at it, the different options that we have. And the other one is a microwave transmission. Especially this microwave transmission is a point to point communication. You cannot have anything in between, but it is basically, it is used in a point to point communications. Okay, and the other option that you have, it is infrared and millimeter. These infrared, okay, high frequency, so a short range communications we will try to use it. The example is the TV remotes that we are going to use it in our home appliances, okay, where you're trying to operate your TV using your remote, okay, where the communication that you have between your remote and TV is basically a wireless communication which uses this infrared waves. Okay, and the other option that we have, it is light wave transmission. As we said, with this optical waves also a wireless communication is possible. Okay, like suppose if I'm considering a laser lights, okay, so once you are trying to convert your analog information to digital information, all the information is in terms of ones and zeros. So all that I can do, it is I can take that laser and I can make that as a transmitter. Like, because switching on and off of that particular laser, okay, switching on I can take that symbol as one, switching off okay I can take that symbol as zero. So these ones and zeros can be conveyed using your laser light. Okay, that way the other person can see okay at a nearby place using wireless, depending upon what I'm going to get, whether it is on and off, I can decode that particular symbol. Okay, so this wireless communication using these optical waves is also possible, but it is limited to a shorter distances. Out of all these things, okay, we are very much interested in this radio transmission. Okay, that's what we will try to okay explore. Now these are what the different types of these wireless communications. And now okay, I hope everybody okay if you think of what all are these wireless systems that we are using okay in current day. Okay, so I hope everybody will accept that whatever I have listed down, all those, almost all these things we have, we are using it, like cellular system, the mobiles everybody is using, and then LANs. Okay, I hope when you are in the college, okay, I hope you have wireless LANs that were available, and I hope everyone have used it. And then from the satellite systems, Okay, like we are watching our TVs, okay, sitting in homes. Like if you wanted to have a live cricket match and all, okay, live streaming is happening in your TV using your satellites. Okay, so hence we are using that particular system also. And for a short range, we have used probably Bluetooth or Zigbee. Okay, all these are the existing and known wireless systems. Okay, in our particular syllabus, what we do is in this wireless communications, we'll especially deal with cellular systems. So we'll try to look at basic cellular concepts, or what do you mean by cell, and right from the beginning of the cell to the future generation mobiles. Okay, what are all the things that we have in this particular cellular systems, we'll try to cover. But the aspects, okay, for rest of the wireless systems would also be quite similar, but okay, the medium, okay, may be different, because these cellular systems try to operate it on 5 kilometers distance. Probably the LANs, you may reduce it somewhat shorter distances. Satellites, you'll try to go for very large distances. Bluetooth and Zigbee will try to go for very small distances. So all that is the medium and the the distance that it has to propagate would be different. Okay, but rest of the aspects with respect to these, okay, would be same. So our major focus, okay, should be on cellular systems. Okay, so just for understanding sake, okay, I've took this picture from somewhere and I've kept it. Okay, so just to understand what do you mean by cellular system, probably from the next class onwards, okay, we will try to look at each and every part of this particular cellular system. As of now, just to understand, okay, I'll quickly just go through what is happening inside this particular cellular system. Okay, for example, if you are the user sitting here, wanted to make a particular call, okay, then you will be communicating to the base station. This is the base station, okay, and the area covered by this particular base station would be this hexagonal cell, and area covered by this base station would be this hexagonal cell, and the area covered by this is this hexagonal cell. Suppose a person in this cell, okay, want to communicate with a person in this particular cell, then the process would be this, okay, the moment when this particular person makes a call, okay, will be reaching to the nearest base station, and then this base station is being connected to mobile switching center, and at the same time this base station is also being connected to mobile switching center, and these things you can see that these are wired communications. And then the moment when you have call, this will inform to the other base station that somebody wants to make a call to a person who is inside this particular cell. Then this will communicate with the corresponding person, okay, and then after this particular negotiation, a channel will be allocated to this particular user, and then he will be communicating, these two will be communicating with each other. Okay, so this is the procedure that we will try to follow in case of a cellular system. Okay, so the basic structure of the cellular system is the cell, a base station inside that particular cell, okay, and then these base stations are being connected to mobile switching center, and then you can see that, okay, you can have a large distance communication because this MSC is in turn connected to public switch telephone network, which is what is basically the initial days communication where everything is connected with a wires. Still at the back end you have this telephone network. Okay, now if I'm trying to look at the wireless aspect in this scenario, you can see that you have this wireless communication between your base station and this mobile handset only here, and rest of the things from here to here it is a wired communication, and anywhere also is this completely is now a wired communication. Only the wireless aspect is here. Okay, so this is the basic concept of this particular cellular systems, and you have a lot many things in this particular cellular system. So probably, okay, from the next class onwards, we'll try to see basically what do you mean by a cell. Okay, and then we will try to see how do we deploy a particular base station, and why do we need to consider hexagonal cell shape, and how many antennas or what antennas that we have to put it. Okay, All these things we will try to cover. And other important portion is when this particular person moves from this area to other area, the call has to be handed over from this base station to another base station. So all these aspects we will try to look at it in your cellular systems. Just to have an understanding or to have an overview of a cellular system, I have kept this particular picture. Okay. But before getting into the actual details of that, as I said, today's topic would be majorly on the challenges of this wireless medium. So just let us look at it, the different challenges that we have in case of your wireless communications. See, understanding these concepts is quite simple, and these are very, very important in understanding the concepts of wireless communications. Okay, this is what the basic difference that we have in case of your wireless communications. Okay, so as I said, again, this is a wireless system that I'm trying to consider, where you have a transmitter and a receiver. Okay, so the first challenge that you have, it is, as I said, transmitter and receiver. I'm putting it as efficient hardware design. Okay, because these are being connected through a wireless. Hence, now suppose let us consider that this is a base station, transmitter is a base station, and then receiver is a mobile handset. Now, the challenge that you have, it is the hardware part of your receiver. Okay, because the basic resources for a communication system is basically, the basic resources are power and bandwidth. Okay, now as far as the power is concerned, suppose if the receiver, if I'm designing my hardware in such a way that it is consuming more and more amount of power, okay, within no time, because obviously when I say this is wireless, obviously this receiver has to be operated with a battery. Okay, the moment when it is operating with a battery, and if the hardware present in this particular receiver, if it is trying to take up or consume more and more amount of power, okay, so definitely the battery gets drained, okay, quickly. And then what you have to do is, you may have to quickly, again, you have to go back and you have to recharge it. Okay, so that is the biggest challenge that we have. I hope that we are using it, our mobile handsets. Okay, first and foremost thing, when we are trying to purchase, we'll try to see what is the battery backup. Okay, that comes, that is basically the hardware specification that we have. That means hardware, whatever that we're trying to design, should be in a position, to use minimum amount of power consumption, so that the battery, should be, lasting for a long time. That is the, difficult part that we have in case of the hardware design. And apart from that, in this particular hardware, we have seen different channel encoders, channel decoders, and then modulators, and all those things are available. But now what you have to do is, what is the thing that you have to make use of it? How do we need to make use of it? Okay, which one suits for these particular applications, especially the modulators and all those things. Okay, you have to design those things very efficiently. Okay, so the hardware design has to be very efficient. That is the first challenge that we have. And then, as we said, the medium is common. Okay, so the medium is common. So, as we said, we do not have any single path between your transmitter and receiver. Now, the moment when the medium is common, the resources, whatever that are available, would also be common for everyone. Now, you have to utilize that particular resources very efficiently. For example, so the second one that I'm trying to, the second challenge that I'm putting it is, the medium is common, so the radio, efficient usage of the radio spectrum, the channel, whatever the channel that is available with us, how effectively we are trying to utilize that particular resources. To understand this radio spectrum concept, quickly, I'll take up an example of the, example for the second generation mobile, which is GSM. I hope everybody understands spectrum is basically the range of frequencies. For GSM, so let's assume that this is the complete spectrum that I have, starting from 1 hertz to 1 terahertz or something. Out of that, what is the spectrum that is being allocated for GSM? Okay, so I'm trying to make use of, okay, for uplink and for downlink, I'm trying to make use of two different. Okay, so let me just try to look at it, that okay, 890 megahertz to 915 megahertz. This is the frequency band or the spectrum that is allocated for GSM. Okay, this is for uplink and this is for downlink. You can understand this mobile to base station, and this is from base station to mobile. That means if you want to have a 2G communication, you are supposed to use only these particular frequencies. Okay, now so what is the bandwidth available with us? So total 25 megahertz bandwidth that is available. And of course, okay, why do we have these two, mobile to base station and base station to mobile? To have a two-way communication. Okay, so you are trying to, it is kind of, you are trying to talk with this, you are trying to talk with this, and you are trying to receive with this. Both cannot be same. If both of them are same, you will get interference. To avoid that, okay, you are trying to put up a separate spectrum for uplink and separate spectrum for downlink. Okay, so in GSM you have 25 megahertz bandwidth that is available, right from 890 megahertz to 915 megahertz, and in downlink 935 to 960 megahertz. And how do we use this spectrum efficiently? That is what is very important. As we said, the medium is common. Okay, anybody can access this. So how efficiently we are making use of this? Okay, you can see that. Now what we are trying to, what generally will be done, it is, I hope you might have seen the concepts of multiple access techniques. Okay, I'm trying to refer to a concept of frequency division multiple access, but anyhow, okay, forget about that, just understand this, you will understand the concept. So you have total 25 megahertz bandwidth. The specification for that is, you can see that I'm dividing this complete thing into different parts. You can see that 890.0 to 890.2 means what? You have a bandwidth of 200 kilohertz here. Okay, that means each one at 200 kilohertz and so on. So I'm dividing this completely 25 megahertz bandwidth into smaller bandwidths of 200 kilohertz. Okay, why am I doing that is because suppose a user wants to have a channel. Okay, suppose if I want to make a voice call. Okay, what is the bandwidth requirement for a voice call? You know that, okay, the maximum speech signal that you have would be around 4 kilohertz. So to satisfy that sampling and all, okay, twice the maximum frequency, 2 into 5, so you will have 10 kilohertz. Okay, so this particular bandwidth is sufficient to transmit a particular voice call. Okay, but how much amount of bandwidth that we are trying to provide? 200 kilohertz. Means what? Apart from your voice, you can even transmit some data also. So now this total 25 megahertz bandwidth, you are trying to divide it into 200 kilohertz of each, okay, in uplink, as well as same thing we'll try to do it in downlink. And what we are saying is each one is having a bandwidth of 200 kilohertz. Now if I'm asking a question, okay, if I'm asking a question, how many number of channels that are available, or how many number of frequencies that are available in case of this uplink? Okay, that one can calculate. The total bandwidth is 25 megahertz divided by 200 kilohertz each. Okay, so if I'm trying to make, you have total 125 channels available with us. You have 125 number of channels that are available here in case of GSM. Similarly, same 125 number of channels that you have in downlink. Now, if, okay, out of this 125 channels available, okay, you can see that, that means what? What does it mean? You have only 125 channels. Suppose if 125 member of users are trying to communicate at the same time, so you will allot all these channels to them, and then if for 126th person, you will not have any channel available. Okay, then you will send a busy tone for it. Okay, so the basic problem here is how effectively you utilize this 125 number of channels is what very important. That's what we said. The resources are common for everyone, and one has to use very efficiently. Hence, we have kept it as
efficient usage of this radio spectrum. For example, okay, how do you use this efficiently is, you have 125 channels available. For example, let us consider a service provider, Airtel. Let's assume that out of these 125 channels, 25 channels are being given to Airtel service provider. Now this Airtel service provider will have only 25 channels, and he has to manage with that, and he has to cover maximum number of users, right? So what he has to use it is, probably he has to use the concept of frequency reuse. Concept of frequency reuse is basically, you are trying to use this set of frequencies at a nearby place, okay, where the interference from the other thing should be nullified. So that is the basic concept of frequency reuse that we will try to see. So if he is using 5 number of times, so 25 multiplied by 5, so he can cover 125 number of user. Okay, so the concept of frequency reuse, we have to look into it in order to use this radio spectrum efficiently. Or in other words, especially in case of 2G, what we'll try to do is, this is each channel, okay, we call, okay, you have one particular channel and it is being allocated to 8 number of users simultaneously. That means you are trying to make use of the concept of time division multiple access also. Because this time division is also possible because the moment when you are trying to take up a digital information, you can see that each and every sample you are going to get it. Okay, sampling voice signal, the sampling rate is what? 2 into 4, okay, 8 kilohertz. So 1 by 8 is the sampling time. Is that correct or not? So 1 by 8 seconds of time, you are supposed to wait until you get a next sample. During that particular time, you are trying to allot this channel to somebody else. By the time you get, you will get your next sample, okay, your channel will be freed and you will be given back. That way, how many number of users, okay, can be covered? Each channel can be covered, given to simultaneously 8 number of users. So 125 multiplied by 8 would be the number of users that we are going to cover. So that means on top of that, you have to use different multiple access techniques in order to improve the capacity of that particular system. Hence, the basic challenge that you have is what? You need to make use of this particular radio spectrum very efficiently. That is the biggest challenge, okay, that we are trying to consider. And then apart from that, as we said, other challenge that you have, it is fading. Again, if I'm trying to look at the concept of fading, okay, so as we said, again, you are trying to consider a wireless communication. Okay, fading is basically because of the multi-path propagation of the signal. Okay, just let's understand through the particular diagram. Now, some information has to be transmitted from transmitter and receiver. So the medium is common, okay, a free space. So medium can have anything. You may have a moving car, or you may have a tree, or you have some building. Now what will happen, it is, you have a line of sight component. Okay, the information will be reaching to your, okay, receiver from a line of sight component. At the same time, this signal, because it is free to go in any path, unguided medium, so hence it can, okay, go to this particular tree, reflect and get back to your receiver, okay, or it may go to this particular building, or it may come back, or it may reflect from this particular car and will come back. Now you can see at the receiver, because of this multiple paths of the information, which is what I am calling it as multi-path propagation. Because of this multipath propagation, what is happening here, it is, you have multiple components present at the input of your receiver. Okay, now sometimes it may go constructive or it may go destructive. If it goes destructive, then you lose complete signal. So this concept of multipath propagation, multiple components, okay, reaching at the receiver, and okay, will have some kind of, okay, noise or the effect that you have, and that particular effect we call it as fading effect. Okay, so just to quickly understand what this multipath propagation will do is, it basically creates inter symbol interference. Just to understand, okay, say this is the first symbol that I'm trying to transmit from the transmitter, and this is the next symbol, second symbol from the transmitter. These are symbols. 0 to t, t to 2t, two symbols that I'm trying to transmit. Now, what will happen? It is first symbol when I'm trying to transmit, you can see that this is being, you can see that, okay, you have some amount of delay that is inevitable. So that delay I'm trying to repeat it here. So the pulse is being received here. Of course, this delay would be same for this also. But at the same time, what will happen? It is not only this, apart from this, I am getting this also. But of course, this path of this is okay longer, so it takes much time. So the another replica of the same will be received at the receiver with some delay. Okay, now because of this, what is happening? You can just see here the inter symbol interference. This symbol is getting interfered with the next symbol. This is the concept, we call it as inter symbol interference. So because of this multipath propagation, you have a problem called inter symbol interference. One has to avoid this particular, overcome this particular inter symbol interference. Okay, and other challenges are, you need to provide the integrated service. Means what? The services are different. Okay, one may require a voice service, or maybe somebody wants to download a movie, or somebody wants to use the multimedia content. Each and every service will have different requirements. So your system should provide in, system should be in such a way that it has to integrate all the services, and then it has to provide that particular services. That is the biggest challenge that we have. That means with single mobile, it should be in a position to use for voice communication, to download a particular movie, or to watch a live cricket match. For all these things, okay, requirements are different, and all the services has to be integrated. Okay, that's the biggest challenge that we have. And at the same time, the last one would be the network need to be supported for mobile users. Okay, so a mobile user moving from one cell to another cell, okay, the different network, okay, should be adaptable for this particular user. Okay, he can be, he should be in a position to switch to that particular network. Okay, these are the basic challenges that we have in case of your wireless communication. Now I'll quickly look at the different generations or cellular generations that we'll try to consider. Okay, and then we'll try to stop. Okay, so cellular generations are basically first generation we used to have from 1980 to 1990, and it was basically intended for voice. Okay, first generation mobiles. Okay, and then it was basically analog communication, and the multiple access techniques that we were using is frequency division multiple access, and the data rate was around 2 kbps. It was very low, as it was purely meant for voice. This is an example analog mobile phone system for first generation. And for the second generation, it was from 1990 to 2000, and improvements were made. Apart from that voice, a small amount of data option is also being given, and during that particular time, the analog signal, okay, is being converted to digital. Okay, so with the advent of this particular digital, now from here on everything was digital. The multiple access techniques that we have used was, okay, TDMA or CDMA. That is what just now we have used, FDMA combination with TDMA. Okay, and you can see that there is significant improvement in the data rate, 14.4 to 64 kbps. And the example, I hope most of you might have known it, GSM, global system for mobiles. This is the example for second generation mobiles. And for third generation, this is 2000 to 2010, and not only voice and data, multimedia content and everything that we would like to have. Okay, probably this is what you might have used most of the time, 3G as well as 4G. Okay, and you can see more or less specifications are same. Then you can see that the data rate improvement, it is around 144 kbps to 2 mbps. Okay, that is the reason why, okay, as the video calling option and all those things are possible. And the example for this is WCDMA. And the other generation is fourth generation. The basic difference from for 3G and 4G is the multiple access techniques, orthogonal frequency division multiple access. In case of orthogonal frequency division multiple access, we'll try to make use of orthogonal carriers that we'll try to use, and try to see that the biggest advantage that you have here is the data rate, 100 Mbps to 1 Gbps. So you can see that there is significant improvement in the data rate, okay, as the generation progresses. Okay, and in the example for long-term evolution, that is LTE, and the last one is the future, that is 5G, expected from 2020 to 2030, and then OFDMA. And you can see that this is the very important thing, that is the data rate. It is able to provide a data rate of greater than 1 gigabits per second. Because see, as you keep on moving from first generation to fifth generation, okay, as and when the user gives us some requirements, he'll say that, okay, I would like to, okay, like say, for example, in 1G, it was only for voice. And then user was not satisfied and he will say that, okay, no, I'm not satisfied with this. I would like to have some data. Like, I would like to check my mail. And then probably by the time 3G comes, okay, his requirement was, no, I would like to watch movie on it, or I would like to have a video call. So as and when, okay, we are keep on moving from here to here, the requirements are being, okay, changing, and accordingly the technologies are being changing. Okay, hence, as the requirement is changing, the amount of data rate that is required for, or bandwidth required for the services is also changing. Hence, accordingly, the data rate is also getting changed. Okay, this is what we expect the fifth generation mobiles. This is just an overview of different cellular systems. Okay, in case of your cellular communications. Okay, and this is what, okay, I thought of giving as an introduction, and these are what the reference textbooks that one can make use of it. Okay, especially the Rapoport textbook, the first one. Okay, and then the probably the later portions will try to go for this Aditya K. Jagannathan, Principles of Modern Wireless Communication Systems. These are the textbook that I would be referring it. Okay, now, okay, so just let me come back just a minute. I'll just come back here.